away. It's like no matter how hard you're wiping, it's just hanging in. All right, Exodus 29. And some verses we've read before, but now we're going to emphasize just a little more. Verses 32 and 33. The last couple of classes, we've been dealing with the fact that not only did you offer the right offering, but in the case of the consecration of the priests, that you were required to eat of that offering, which is very different. There's only one offering that you really do that with, and that's the peace offering. And of course, if you've studied the progression of the sacrifices, you know that there's sin offering, trespass offering, and those fall into the category of sin offerings or offerings strictly for what we've done wrong. But you also know that there is a category called sweet savor offerings, which have nothing to do with sin at all. They are offerings that we offer to Him because of our love and our desire towards Him and because of certain attributes of Him that we have recognized. And among those is the last one to be offered usually is a peace offering. And that's what we find here. It says in verse 32, "And Aaron and his son shall eat the flesh of the ram and the bread that is in the basket by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. They shall eat those things wherewith the atonement was made to consecrate and to sanctify them, but a stranger shall not eat thereof because they are holy." Let's turn to Genesis 14, and I just want to make a reference again to Melchizedek. And I primarily want to do this because I never know how these teachings are going to be disseminated. Sometimes people break them up into like a study on Melchizedek, and that would be separate from what it means to be a New Testament priest. So if that be the case, I would like it said within the consecration of the priests. Just a small note about the difference between a mediator priest and a communion priest. And we see in Genesis 14 the first mention of Melchizedek. And in verse 18, "And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God." He was king, and all these kings had gathered together. But he presented himself not as a king, he presented himself as a priest. And the priest that he was Melchizedek, but the full comprehension of Melchizedek is he is the priest of the Most High. What is Most High? High to God. We've discussed that. But bringing these things out, you have to realize the difference between a mediator priest and a communion priest, because if you don't, you will not live as a New Testament priest, but as an Old Testament priest. And the difference is that an Old Testament priest was always mediating between someone and God, trying to get them to God, trying to bring them to God. And the New Testament, it declares that the work of Christ as a mediator is done. He brought us to God. All the offerings have been offered, and you're not going to get to God. You're already there if you're a believer. He's not trying to get you to God. He's trying to keep you in the understanding of what has been accomplished. And you see that in 1 Peter 1, 5, and Philippians 4 is probably the most common one where it talks about that he keep your hearts and minds. And notice the word keep instead of bring, to keep you in this thing, not bring you to it. It may feel like you're being brought to it, but the truth is it can't be a finished work unless it's finished. Right? Isn't it strange how we can have the ability to call this a finished work all the time and yet never see the finishedness of it? We always think, well, I've got to do something else, or this is going to happen, or that's going to happen. Folks, if you sin, Jesus has already died. He's not going to come back and die again. He's not going to do a new work. He's not going to do a work to solve your sins. He's done the work. Now he wants to keep you in that. Amen? So Melchizedek was a communion priest, and we see that in that he brought bread and wine. And that comprehension is so important, and that comprehension is seen in that the priests, when God was first consecrating them, yes, he dealt with a sin offering. Yes, he dealt with a burnt offering. But finally, the final offering that settled it all was a peace offering in which they had communion, or they ate of the sacrifice that was offered to God. In other words, and I've mentioned this, when it says God is a consuming fire, it means that he consumes the sacrifice. He eats it. He takes it in. He, you know, takes it all and consumes it. And so, now he does that with the burnt offering, and we have no communion with him in that. Nobody eats of the burnt offering. Nobody eats of the sin offering. Nobody eats of any of the other offerings. But once you have come to this place of peace, then you eat of what he eats. You don't just eat with him now. Let's make this absolutely clear. You don't just sit down and eat with him. You eat what he eats. I already lost my place there, but we eat of the things whereof the atonement was made. And frankly, the word atonement isn't always just applied to sin. It means to finish out the work, the full work. It would be like the work of salvation isn't just to save you from hell. It's to save you from punishment. It's to redeem you unto God. It's to bring you into oneness. That's full salvation. It's not just about, you know, getting you out of something. It's bringing you into something. And so it's so important that you realize that every New Testament priest doesn't go through the physical elements of this, but they must go through the spiritual reality, and the spiritual reality is the reality, and what these priests did was the shadow. So we find these things to be real in our lives. And so, like I said, anytime you eat of the same thing God eats and you are partaking of what sustains him, you are partaking of what it was that he wanted you to give, but you're living off of the same thing, then you're coming into communion. You're not just a Christian. You're not just a believer. You're coming into being a New Testament priest, of which all of us are supposed to be. There is no separate thing, you know. So eating the same food represents fellowship. It represents fellowshipping with him on the things that he wants us to eat. So it's called a peace offering because that's when we sit down, and anytime a person is able to sit down and eat together with him over what is acceptable to him, they're at peace. A lot of times we're not at peace with God because many times the reason why we're not at peace with God is because God wants a certain thing and we're not willing. Has that ever happened with anybody? You know, God's after a certain thing and we don't want to give that up, or we don't want to do that, or we don't want to, you know. I remember when I was in Bible school, and part of the training for our Bible school was that we would become missionaries. So, the term got used an awful lot, you know. Well, I can't trust God. If I just say yes, I'll be a missionary, he's liable to send me off to Kalamazoo or who knows where. And I kept hearing that and hearing that. Finally, one day I looked it up, and Kalamazoo is just in Michigan. My God, it's not that, you know. It's not like, you know. Wait a minute, it's just here in Michigan. I'll go to Michigan. Yes, Lord. You know, but that's what, you know, that was the phrase everybody was doing. Well, you never know. God might send you off to who knows where, Kalamazoo. So I'm sure the Michigans are going, well, we could use some more Jesus up here. Come on. Oh, yeah, there we go. I actually didn't see your face, but I saw a head going like this. I went, there we go. We got proof. Praise God. So this is a thing of peace. When we're sitting down with Him, we're communing with Him over what He wants to commune over, which is completely different than just being a Christian. The example being, we're a Christian, He's God, and we go into the throne room, and we run up to the throne, and we tell Him all of our troubles, and we tell Him what we want, and we tell Him how we want it, we tell Him when we want it, and then we leave. There's no real communion in that. You understand what I mean? It's not like we're even discussing it with Him. Can I get an amen? I mean, it's pretty much we're doing all the talking. You know, that's a one-sided relationship. And so we go, oh, Lord, I need this and I need that. And, you know, I'm in a big hurry. I got to get it. Okay, got to go. I'm, you know, sure. Glad. Oh, what a wonderful time we had together. And He's going, hi. You know, just trying to spend a little time with us. Well, we won't do that over our things. We won't do that until we've come to His things, the things that are important to Him, the things that, I mean, consider this. He's God. He created the material world. Then He specifically created you, and He wants you to come into the things that are important to Him because He made it all with purpose. Amen. Is that sort of, you know, it's like He didn't make us so that, you know, it's almost like this. In some places they teach God made you and God's got a perfect will for your life, meaning He's got just the right house you're going to have and the right spouse and how many kids and 3.2 kids and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And it's all figured out. And that's really what God's about. He doesn't really have any other agenda other than to provide you with exactly what you were destined to have. Folks, I can tell you right now what you're destined to have is the cross. You can't get to eating these things without first everything going through what? The altar. It's just a fact. It's just a fact. And so there is this reality that there are things that He wants to commune with us over, that He wants us to partake of, not just to partake of because this will enhance your life. Yes, it will. Not just to partake of because this will bring peace in new ways. Yes, it will. But to look Him in the eyes and see what brings joy to His heart and eat of the same thing and fellowship in it. There is a spirit behind communion, in other words. I was raised in the United Methodist Church. First of all, the one I went to, they didn't even talk about being born again. You just got saved if you went down as a little baby and they sprinkled some water on your head and that's good. And my opinion of that is, had I died being a United Methodist, I'd have burned in hell forever. That's my opinion. And so you could take communion. And when you took communion, the important thing was to be very reverent and quiet when you did it. Okay, because the ritual was holy. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Obviously, if you've been raised in this church, You don't see that so much because the ritual isn't what it's about. The reality is there's a spirit behind it. There's meant to be something of communion with the Lord in what? Not just in general things or subjects, but in his body and in his life and communing with him in those things. So there is a spirit behind the whole thing. There is a reality to the Lord's table. The Lord's table, you know. And so we don't eat at our table. We don't go and eat what satisfies us. We eat at the Lord's table. What he's serving, what he serves up. Amen? And that's the case. I mean, you look at the offerings and everything. Eventually, it eroded down to Eli being the high priest and his sons being the priests. And they had this, they made up new rules. They didn't just want what God gave them. They wanted what they wanted. And they learned to do it with hooks. They would be roasting or boiling, and they would take a hook, and they made a law that anything that the hook went into was theirs. You can read it in the Old Testament. And so, you know, the whole idea was to satisfy themselves and to get more for what they wanted instead of what God wanted. And to let God have his portion and let the priests have their portion. And so you get a little bit of picture of that over in Luke 15 when you see a drastic change. Look at the relationship here with the prodigal son. See if I can find it. Yep. Okay, so there was this son. It's a Luke 15, verse 11 starts the whole thing. And they had two sons, and one went down, and he ended up in the hog pen, and he ended up not eating what was at the father's table. And the whole issue was bread. And if you'll notice in this offering with the priest, part of that thing is bread, and we'll get into that more as we go. We already have in the last class, but we'll do it even more. And so he said, what am I doing? There is bread to eat and in abundance in my father's house. So he goes back and he shows up and he's rehearsing in his mind. Here's what I'm going to do. Soon as I see the father, I'm going to say, Father, forgive me. I've sinned. I'm not worthy. Okay. In other words, your typical way that most Christians approach God instead of sons who are priests approach their father. So he goes, I've sinned, I'm not worthy, you know, all this stuff. But when he sees the father doesn't give him a chance to speak, starts putting stuff on him, dressing him, robing him, communing with him, describing him in a different light. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? I mean, putting shoes on him and putting a robe of righteousness on him and killing the fatted calf and eating of it, communing over the sacrifice. The father didn't even get into the sin issue. Now, if you and I had been the father, we'd have said, you know, we'd have stopped a certain distance. And he'd have stopped, and he'd been in fear and trembling, knowing he's messed up, and knowing he's done all this stuff wrong, and he's scared to come back. And we would have been the father, would have stopped and said, okay, you better repent now, or don't take another step. Because we're still approaching this thing on a mediator type thing instead of on a communion thing. Father went to him. First thing he did was grab him and hug him. He never asked for a repentance. And I'm not saying, but I am saying the spirit in which we approach this most of the time is still Old Testament. He goes over, hugs him, kisses him, starts putting all this, shoving a ring on him, putting all this stuff on him, brings him in, so much so that you end with, I saw it here for a second, verse 23, and bring the fatted calf and kill it and let us eat. And it could be just as well said, and let us eat together and be merry. And let us eat together. Let us commune in these things. Let us gather to the Father's table and commune over the sacrifice that has been put to death, of which now we're going to eat, son. Can I get amen? Amen. That's the deal. You know what he did when he killed the fatted calf? He said, son, you're already dead. The price for your sin has already been paid. A sacrifice has died. But now, instead of living your own life and going out there and gathering up the inheritance that you want so that you can live the way you want, now we're going to eat of the same thing in the same house and live by the same spirit. The father was a communion priest. And again, if you're, Jesus was a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. That's what the Word of God says. But it also says that we are all priests. Do you think Jesus is a high priest after the one order and we're a priest after another order? And the answer would be no. We're all after that same order, and that order is communion. When Melchizedek showed up, man, he's feeding bread and wine. He's breaking bread. He's breaking communion. He's saying, man, we're fellowshipping in this same life, the same self-giving nature of which you just manifested when you saved your enemies. And so communion, you hear Jesus saying, I have with much desire to have this communion with you. We go, it's just communion, Jesus. Don't get so excited. It's no big deal. It's not that big a deal. It's just a few little elements here, and we'll just eat them down and go, yay, and then move on. But Jesus is responding in a completely different way. This is my body. This is my life poured out. Drink it, eat it, become one with me in this thing. Hallelujah. I was thinking about turn with me to Mark. I think it's chapter 2. Yeah, Mark chapter 2 and verse 13. Well, let's read we'll start there. And he went forth again by the seaside, and all the multitude resorted unto them, and he taught them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax office, and said unto him, follow me. And he rose and followed him. All right, I found this interesting set of scriptures here, because here you have Jesus and you have how people relate to Jesus. And he said, and went forth by the seaside, and the multitude resorted unto them, and he taught them, and they got just great, great teachings. And then he left that, and as he passed by, he saw Levi, who was a tax collector. And what's the other name that's used for Levi? Matthew. Okay, so he saw Matthew, but he saw Levi, and as he passed by, he said, come, follow me. Now, all the multitude are going, man, we never heard anybody teach like this. That was one of the best sermons I ever heard in my life. You see, as if Jesus came to be known as the great sermon giver. Like that would please him. Folks, he came to make us one with him of his same kind, and to be partakers of his nature, the divine nature, which is self-giving. But he sees this one guy, and his name's Levi. And I thought, now isn't that interesting? It was the tribe of Levi that was chosen to be the priests. Isn't that funny? The tribe of Levi. And so I thought in my mind, okay, I need to follow this out. I need to think about this. I need to meditate on this. I need to ponder this, because I think there's something to this that Jesus taught the multitudes, and then when he saw Levi, but he was a tax collector, he said, come follow me. Come follow me. Not just hear me, Not just hear my teachings, but come follow me. And as I thought about it, I thought, oh my goodness. Matthew became a communion priest. How do I know that? Because his name was Levi? No, not good enough. His name was Levi when he was still a publican, or a tax collector. Okay. No. When you study out Matthew or Levi, you have almost no mention after this of him, of what he did, of where he went, of what his life was like after he you know, started following the Lord and Jesus raised from the dead. Nothing. Nothing. No anything except one thing. One thing and one thing only. It's a book called Matthew. And it's all about Jesus. The man that we know nothing of his life afterwards, nothing of his Christian life, we only know one thing. He sat down and he made a big old table called Matthew. And he's been feeding people on Jesus ever since. Hallelujah. What an incredible reality that he did become a communion priest. And the greatest proof of that isn't his great ministry, isn't what he did, was simply, and who knows, he may not have known that when he wrote the book of Matthew, it was going to be saved, preserved, and feed people Jesus from then on. He may not have known that. He may have just simply had it in his heart that I want to feast on what, you know, what God feasts on, and I want to feed that to other people. And maybe he just wrote it to somebody or a small group of people. But it's feeding, and it's feeding, and it's still feeding Christ. And he is forever a priest after the order of Melchizedek, still bringing about communion to this day. So anyway, I just thought, you know, are we gathering around the table of the Lord, or are we gathering around our table? Are we setting on our table all the things that we care about and then get upset with God because he doesn't jump in the big middle and fix everything for us? You know, because we're self-focused. And I, you know, let me just say this. I understand being self-focused. I understand being selfish. I understand being self-centered. It is our nature. It is not natural to us to be self-giving. It is easy as pie to simply think about ourselves, think about our needs, worry about what's important to us, worry about how we're going to look or how we're going to appear to people. I understand that. You know, I'm probably one of the few people that look at that, and instead of condemning it, I go, you know what? That is what we are if it's not Jesus. If Christ is not formed in us, that's what we are. You know, it's like coming up to a bloodhound who's laying on the porch and say, you stupid old bloodhound, lazy old thing. You just lay on the porch all the time. Only time you jump up is when you sniff out a raccoon or something and take off, but you're just a lazy, no good for nothing dog. And he goes, yeah, I am what I am. Get off my back. I was sleeping. You know? But we're all into condemning Adam instead of bringing Christ. I see Adam in you. Well, trust me, God sees Adam in you. Maybe even in the pointing of the finger, God sees Adam. God sees pride. Well, you messed up, and I need to really make a big deal out of that so that I look better. How about just communion and lifting up Jesus? And I got news for you. Anybody you side with that really goes after somebody and attacks somebody, I want to tell you something. If that's their spirit and their way, eventually when that's no longer an issue, they're going to turn on you. Because why? They're going to see something in you. Do you believe there's something in you that's wrong? And they're going to treat you the same way with the same venom that they treated somebody else. So you might as well register that, because it probably will happen. And, you know, it's like good to know that and then fall into it. It's better to know that and not commune. You say, where do you get that from, Brother Randy? Well, let's go to Luke over here. Luke chapter 22. Just before Passover, where the communion is. And in this case, I'm going to be reading out of the King James, because there's one word that they've replaced here and is in your margin, translated different. But let's start in verse 1 of Luke 22. Now, the Feast of Unleavened Bread drew near, which is called the Passover. Do you see what is supposed to, the Passover represents communion or the Lord's table. That's when it all took place. Do I get an amen on that? It's all one. It took place and was instituted within the same thing. And the chief priests and scribes sought how they might kill him. The chief priests and I want you to notice they're talking about Passover here, but they're not talking about communing over it. They're talking about killing it. Okay? That they might. Which is called Passover, and the chief priests and scribes sought how they might kill him, for they feared the people. Then entered Satan into Judas, surnamed Iscariot, being of the number of the 12. And now look at this. And he went his way, and here's where I'm reading the King James. This is talking about Judas. And Judas went his way and communed with the chief priests and captains, how he might betray him unto them. You see it there in your King James? Judas was in communion. With what? Oh, the priesthood. Wrong priesthood. You know, oh, we're priests. We're always talking about God and doing God things and everything. But they got one thing on their mind, and that is to kill the sacrifice instead of feed it to everyone else. You see? And so Judas is eating of the same thing that they're eating of. They're the same thing that motivates them, motivates him. He can say, I'm one of the 12, I'm different, but he's one of them. He's communing with them. He's leaving the Passover and not communing with Jesus over his body and his blood. And he's communing with them over pride, over self-protection. Let's protect the priesthood. You know, don't you think that those priests thought, man, this Jesus is going to mess everything up. To keep the priesthood pure, we need to kill. Come on, folks. Those kind of thoughts go through people's minds. To keep things pure, to warn everybody, we need to do this. To do this, we got to do this. And it's all actions, I'm not even going to say evil. I'm just going to say of the same of what these, you know, Judas and the priest were of the same. They communed, they ate of the same thing. Now, of course, the sacrifice wasn't going to be them. You do know the Melchizedek priest, that he offered himself and his flesh for them to have life. The priest offered himself. He's the only one. All the other priests offered everything else, something other than themselves. That's Jesus, folks. When are we going to lay down our lives for the brethren? By this perceive we the love of God. Well, let's not talk about the love of God. Let's talk about the righteousness of God. Folks, the righteousness of God is fulfilled by the cross and what Jesus did when he put us to death. And now he says, eat my flesh and drink my blood. And when he clothes those priests, yes, he clothes them in robes of white. And then he splatters his blood and oil all over them and marks them and, you know, makes them look all splattered, because they're only clean not by being lily white, but by being washed in the blood. And folks, everything in that sanctuary was consecrated by blood. No, not because everything was sinful. Do you think the ark was sinful? Come on. You think everything in the Holy of Holies was sinful? No, but blood represents the life of Christ. No, it represents the poured out, self-giving life of Christ. And everything better have that touch or it's got nothing. It's got no eternal reality to it. It's just got a religious, a ritualistic significance, which we make the religious, ritualistic things holy, and we leave Jesus out. And that's exactly what the high priest and the Pharisees did with Jesus. They said, you're going to mess up our rituals. And our rituals are of God. Their rituals were of God, but their rituals were not God himself. They were of God, but they were not God. And we make them God. Amen. We make them God. And therefore we'll kill the Son of God, and which is a self-giving lamb. Do you understand what I just said? We will kill the self-giving one to defend God's righteousness. You can't defend God's righteousness. The only way you can stand up for it is to stand up and die and let Christ be made unto you righteousness and wisdom and sanctification and redemption, so that he that glories doesn't have pride. We call it religious pride. Folks, it's not religious pride. It's just pride. It's just pride. Well, some athlete walks around going, yeah, you know. I mean, I remember a boxer used to say, I'm the greatest and everything. And, you know, and I don't know, he's not so great now, and I'm not being critical. I'm just saying. I mean, he's, you know, walk around with that. But then I see guys on TV, and they're just flaunting themselves and the pride that comes out of them. I know that there is people that call it religious pride, and folks, it's not Jesus. It is not Jesus. Jesus told the story of religious men, that there was a man beat up and thrown in the street, and religious men were standing up for God and going about God's business and busy passing him one after another, until some guy that the Jews hated, Samaritans, and he stops and he takes him and he cleanses his wounds. They don't owe him anything. He don't even know him. Cleanses his wounds, washes his wounds, pours in the oil and the wine. Amen. Then he takes him, puts him up, and then says, well, I do have to go, but I'm going to come back. And if there's anything over and above that I'm not paying right now, I'll take care of it. And Jesus says, which one is fulfilling the second commandment to love your neighbor as yourself? And the Pharisees go, ooh, is that Samaritan? You know, I'm telling you that love is a motivation that's eternal. There is faith. There is hope. Who was it? Carolyn and I were talking about this, that when you're walking in faith, you're walking in the reality of the Lord, and you're able to walk with him in certain things because your faith is right there with him. But if you're not walking in that, you're sort of messed up. There's still the hope that he is your life and he will manifest. Can I get amen on that? I mean, thank God we have a hope too. I mean, sometimes we don't walk in faith, but it sure is comforting to know that there's a hope and that same one who we will walk in with faith. But you know what? Greater than all that is love. You know? And by this perceive we that love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. And I want you to know, the ones you usually end up laying down your life for is not the ones that are doing so good that they don't need anything. It's not the ones that never mess up. It's the ones that mess up. It's the ones that need the Lord, that need to be fed and reminded and filled up on the reality, the way God views them, that he has died, he settled this, come into communion with me, wash in the water, not just in the blood, yes, wash in the blood, but wash in the water of the word and be cleansed, and let every spot and wrinkle of your misunderstanding clear this away. They're hurting, but they're not needing to be condemned or rejected. They're needing to be told the truth as it is in Jesus and to feed on that. That's simple. Communion priest, after the order of Melchizedek, or trying to reconcile them instead of feeding them on the reconciliation. We say, but it says, you know, that we've been called to the ministry of reconciliation. Be ye reconciled to God. Yeah, but the word be, it didn't say do things to reconcile yourself. It said be, and being is a state of being. Very profound, huh? Being is not a state of doing. Being is different from doing. Doing is different from being. Be, he says in Ephesians, that you might be to the praise of his glory. So we go, okay, I'm going to go out and do all this stuff that'll bring him praise and glory. He didn't say go do stuff. He said find the communion of this thing and be what he's made you. He has already reconciled you. And when he said be reconciled to God, I mean, even that, folks, is just the initial reconciling so that it settles, so that now you can be one. Be one. All right. Gosh, we went around the world on that little thing, didn't we? Lots of different scriptures and views of that. But I mean, what an incredible thing to see Judas and his communion, and Levi and his communion. And I thought, you know, he was Levi, but he never was Levi, never was of the tribe of Levi, never was really that. Even though he had the name, he never did become a decent Levitical priest. He became a priest after the order of Melchizedek. You know? Wouldn't it be wonderful if the church understood that and did like Melchizedek, who was king, but he didn't come in and, you know, I mean, the king of Sodom did, came up to Abraham and said, look, man, you did a great job here, and we're all sort of under your, you know, appreciation and everything for what you've done. Look, why don't you just, give me back the people and stuff, and you can keep the stuff, but, you know, but he's talking to him like a king. And by the way, Abraham, remember, you're not a king. Melchizedek comes, and it says he was king of Salem, but he came with bread and wine, for he was the priest of the Most High God. You're not getting any other office as far as pride and how you present yourself. Somebody says, well, Jesus was a king, and he's made us priests and kings, so what do you do with that? Well, I'm a king, so, you know, nobody's going to walk on me, you know. I mean, I've been told that. Some of you, I even recently said this one, but, you know, somebody a long time ago said, oh, I just love Jesus. I would just do anything for Jesus. I'd be willing to be a doormat in the house of God. And I said, yeah, and the first time somebody wipes their feet on you, how are you going to react? Isn't that, I mean, you know, we're all humble. Oh, this service has just made me. That question isn't how do you feel at the end of a wonderful worship service. The question is, what is the government of your life? Is Christ everything? Is feeding on him everything to you? Because why? Because it's everything to him, and therefore you're going to feed that to as many people as you can. All right, let's go to John chapter 6. Last class we did quite a bit of searching in John. I just want to bring out one more major thought here. John 6. Now, you remember we read at the beginning of this class this reality of they didn't just eat of the sacrifice, but bread. And it's really, really important to understand that. John 6 and verse 56. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. Now this is interesting. You remember last class, we discovered that the word eat was actually, there were two separate words used at different times in this sixth chapter. One meant phago, which is to consume and to take it in, and the other was trago, which means to chew on it before you take it in, to really meditate on it, and to, you know. And I'll just tell you this, I mean, for whatever it's worth, but I really try to spend a lot of time meditating on something. In other words, I may only get a few minutes to read something, but when I read it, instead of just taking it for what it is, for example, the scriptures, the two scriptures that we gave you, but certainly the one with Levi, to meditate and chew and chew and chew, because the more you do, the more it breaks down, the more the Holy Spirit is able to show you Christ. But if you don't, you just read and then you stop and you say, well, I can't wait to get another chance to read, and then you read and you stop. Then nothing's really getting in. Well, in this verse, there's a different word being used also. In verse 56, he that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood, and it's the word dwelleth in me and I in him. The word dwell there, the word dwell or dwelleth is the same exact word used in this same book, only a few chapters forward, John 15, where Jesus says, I am the vine, you're the branches, abide in me, abide. This word dwell is the same word as abide. And that's important. Abiding then, because has anybody ever like wrestled with, well, what does it mean to abide? Jesus wants me to abide in him. I want to abide. Or how do I abide? You know, is it just stay a Christian? I'm abiding. Is that what it is? But you can clearly tell that that's not what's going on. So abiding is in line with communion here and in line with this whole chapter, and he's about to wrap up this whole chapter of I am the bread of life. Eat my flesh and drink my blood. Dwelling here is actually the word abiding. For example, a branch that abides in a vine feeds off of it and off of the life of the vine itself. It is feeding off of that and it's drawing the very life of the vine into it. Is that right? If you take a branch, and you've heard me use my example when I was a missionary in Jamaica, where a Jamaican man taught me how to graft in a branch off of another tree into one, and we cut a cross shape into the thing, we wounded the vine, opened it up, stuck the branch in, and then we wrapped it up. But folks, the wrapping is not doing the abiding, it's the catching and feeding off of it that does the abiding. You see what I'm saying? And you have to draw from the life of the vine. To abide in him is to draw from the vine itself. It's to feed off of it. It's to feed off of the very life that it lives by. And so, you know, abiding is not some sort of a theological thing. Well, now that I'm a Christian, I surely must be abiding. And the priests, the sin offering was done in their consecration. It was done. The whole burnt offering was done next. And it was done and settled. And all you have to do is believe in it now. But the priests were to feed with God and to take in the altar, to take in the things that God said, this is what I want. Well, what does he want? You can say he wants Jesus, but in that sacrament, he could have said, I want the lamb, you know, on first Passover down in Egypt. I want the lamb. I want every one of you to go out, look in your flocks, find me a lamb without blemish and spot, put a rope on it, and I want you to walk around with him every day for an hour. That's what I want. I want the lamb in your life. Walk with the lamb. Make sure he's right beside you. You know, and the difference is a big old bad mean wolf comes up, you know, and threatens you and that lamb, the lamb will lay down its life. He's not going to pull out a machete or an Uzi. They're given no weapons. Do you understand? The lamb has no defense at all. No self-defense. Nothing that God, you know. Many animals do, but a lamb doesn't. He has nothing, and you're walking your lamb, and you know you're going, oh, this wolf's fixing to jump on me and eat me. You know, fill him full of lead. By this perceive we the love of God, because He laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. So God had a choice of how to present this whole thing. And the way He presented it was, abide, feed on, take this life into you. Feed off of and out from the lamb, the vine itself, and let His life come on the inside of you. So abiding is simply what? Drawing life from Him. But it is, you know, we say, well, I draw life from Jesus every day. Well, I couldn't even make it through work without Jesus. He gives me life and strength to do that. Folks, it's not saying, you know, Jesus then is just a glorified energy drink. You know, I mean, if that's all, well, glory to God, I'm ready. You know? No. He's saying, partake of this nature and get it inside of you and be this way. Now, we don't always see what that means. We don't always see what that means. We don't always, you can look at the life of Jesus and you see Him curse the fig tree and you go, well, that ain't the lamb. We'd say that to Jesus. You see Paul doing stuff. Well, that ain't the lamb. We can all judge that, but I tell you, there are a whole lot of things that people will do that you'll never know it was the lamb. You'll never know that they went into death over. Why? Because if it's the lamb openeth not his mouth. Is that right? Huh? You'll never know. You'll know somebody else because they'll tell you everything. Well, this and that. What about this? What about that? What about this? And a communion priest would say, what about this bread and this wine? What about this Jesus that's self-giving? What about God saying this is the way we ought to be? What about turning the other cheek? What about going the extra mile? What about laying down your life for the brethren? What about that? All right, I think I'm going to stop a few minutes early just because that energy drink that I mentioned, about five of you need to go drink one. All right, take a break.